conversations, I'm going to start with lots of caveats. So I guess one of them is to say I feel very uncomfortable about giving any sort of advice on this sort of topic. But given how much time I have to spend at the JF thinking about these questions, this seemed like the highest value thing I could probably talk about. I also just want to briefly sort of abuse my position in the ordering. I just wanted to add so Joey and George advocated sending paper copies of papers. I just wanted to add as an extra data point, if you send it to me, then sadly it will just end up in an envelope in my office. So I wish this didn't happen. The envelope will sit there. Each day I'll think I should reopen that envelope. But somehow the envelope will just stay there until 2 years later I'll throw it out. So again, I'm not proud of this. Let me think what else I wanted to say. Also, I also wanted to say two things since I'm coming immediately after Laura's talk. First, I wanted to say, since I'm obviously directly onto the other end of Laura's talk, I thought Laura gave extremely good advice. So I basically fully endorse everything that Laura said on how to respond to that. And then from the other side of this, I should say that when I write these letters to authors, I try as hard as I can to say what I think is important, what I think can safely be ignored. But at the same time, be aware that I at least am doing this, and I think many other people in my position do this too. But at the same time, sometimes it's simply not possible. So when the editor doesn't do this, it's not that they're being, typically it's not that they're being deliberately obtuse, it's the paper really just doesn't let them clearly identify in advance what's going to be important, what's not going to be important. So I guess for more caveats, let me just emphasize, these really are just my thoughts, right? Obviously, I think they're the right views, but in the end, they are just my views. Any rule has exceptions. This is going to be true of anything I say here as well. And then, as some of you will know, my own research is mostly theoretical, so some of the more specific examples I'm going to give are going to be sort of orientated towards sort of theory type things, but some of the more general things I'm going to say are going to apply to everything. And then I want to make sure, so John, let me know when I have 5 minutes left, since I want to make sure to get to the referee part of this. So I'm going to start by saying some things about papers, and I want to say some things about referees at the end. I want to make sure to get to the referee part. Okay, so some other people have said sort of, I would say, moral aversions of this morning. This is reflected in sort of the thing John said right before the break. But I think in the end, like stepping all the way back, thinking about like what are we trying to do when we write a paper, I think in the end it's not that hard to describe what we're trying to do. It's much harder to do it, but what we're trying to do, I think it's not that hard. In the end, like what makes a paper successful, you need to tell the reader something he or she didn't know before reading your paper. And on a topic that the reader actually cares about. Right? So it's obviously easy to say things the reader didn't already know, but they might not be things the reader cares very much about. Right? So you need to tell the reader something they didn't already know and on something they actually care about. So a phrase like that, obviously there's a lot of weight on, well, who's the reader? So then you have to remember, it's tempting to write papers where the reader is perpetually you when you started writing the paper, right? You start thinking, it'd be really interesting to think about what information collection does to asset prices. And you might not know anything about that when you start the paper. I might not know anything about this when I start the paper. But I'm not going to be the reader with the end product. There's a whole bunch of people out there who have already been thinking very hard about this question for a long time, and they're likely to be the referees. They're the readers who matter, not your state as an author when you first started writing the paper. So it's important to remember who the reader is, and the readers who sort of, at least in the short run, matter for your paper are the referees who are going to review the paper, and they're typically experts in your field. Okay, so what you're trying to do is tell experts in the field of working in something they didn't already know about a topic they care about. Okay, so again, easy to describe, not easy to do, but that is ultimately what you're trying to do. Okay, so I want to sort of think about, first I'm going to describe various ways in which sort of you can fail at this. So these are going to be a little bit, I'm going to sort of look at three sort of classes of papers. These are all going to be sort of broadly theory papers, which hopefully will be useful for you, anyway. And then I'll describe a couple of papers which I think have succeeded. So I'm actually going to be, the nature of this is, you know, in preparing these slides, you know, in some sense, these would be better slides if I were very specific and pointed to specific papers that have failed, but that would just be like too harsh. So I'm going to describe in more in general terms papers that have ways to fail, but then I'm going to be much more specific about papers which I think have succeeded, and then I'll talk about some other things. And I guess actually before going into sort of ways to succeed on this within sort of theory papers broadly defined. I should say that, you know, I think for empirical papers, part of what it means to tell the reader something he or she didn't already know, there's a lot of weight here in convincing them that you've sort of got, say, for causality back, right? Part of telling them something they didn't know, it sort of puts, you know, if you've got, why do we care so much about identification? Because the thing you're trying to communicate often is what's causing something, and then telling you something you didn't already know means actually convincing you of what the cause is. Okay, so back to, I'm going to start with sort of describing sort of three classes of theory papers, which broadly I think have a tough time with this. So the first type of paper that I think has a tough time meeting this bar, if you start from some empirical puzzle and you build a model to explain. Okay? And I think the problem with this is at this point in the literature, most readers will feel that sort of people writing theory papers have enough magic tricks up their sleeve that they can write a model to explain it. So that when they read your explanation of this empirical puzzle, they'll feel, I haven't learned anything. I knew this guy had enough cards up his sleeve to explain whatever he wanted, and he's demonstrated that indeed he had enough cards up his sleeve to explain whatever he wanted. So what should you do? Right, so and on each of these, I'm trying to describe how I think you should respond to this broad difficulty. I warn you ahead of time, the solutions are not going to be very easy, but they are broadly what you should do. Right? If this is the sort of paper you're writing, you need to convince the reader that the fundamental economic force in your model also explains other distinct things in the data. Right, so you started with a puzzle, you sort of wrote down this model to explain the thing you said was a puzzle. You had better then convince the reader that you could also explain other things, and importantly, if the main force in the model you started with had better be the force that explains these other things. You can't just add on more stuff to the model to explain this other stuff you want to explain. Right, that's a cheater. So you've got to have the same force explain some other stuff. Or the other way to go here, obviously, is to add some empirical analysis. Now, just as an aside, and I very much regret this, but when papers, although in principle we say papers should have theory and empirics, there is always some risk that when your paper has theory and empirics, you get judged on the minute or two, which is a very unfortunate outcome. I wish it wasn't the case. Again, I do what I can to push back against this, but in truth, there's some of this. Okay, so type number two of paper that has a hard time sort of with sort of communicating to the reader something they already know. You write down a model with multiple economic forces. Like there are various ways you might do this. So a good reason to do this is you want to analyze some very specific policy proposal or some feature of the world. A less good reason to do this is you look at the literature and you say, some papers have this effect in, some papers have that effect in, wouldn't it be interesting to put them together? And the problem here is going to be that after you put them together, you end up with punchlines that are something like, well, the trade-off between these two forces, there's this interesting non-monotonic relationship. Again, I think most readers will come away thinking, this is not, we sort of broadly already knew there was a trick. We broadly already knew the world was complicated and forces can go in complicated ways, and I'm not that surprised that if I build a complicated model, I'm going to get trade-offs and non-monotonic relations. So what should you do? Well, you need to find, this is the place where I really feel the solution is hard, but ideally what should you do? Find a way to assign the net effect, right? If you have lots of things going on, you need to show, you need to find some way to show what it all adds up to. Sometimes you could do this with a nice theoretical argument, that would be like a successful paper, or perhaps you could argue, that the key parameters can be quantified sufficiently precisely that when you work this out quantitatively, we should put some weight on the result. That would be good. Or you can show that the two forces interact in an interesting way. So you might say the two forces act together in a complementary, in the jargon often used, that there's some strategic complementarity between the two forces. Again, you want to be a little bit careful with that. By this time, people are getting a little bit, the idea that forces reinforce each other risks making the reader think, well, I sort of already knew that too. But you sort of, one way or another, you have to find a way to show what it all adds up to beyond just saying there's a trigger. Because I think the reader will think, I already knew it. So a third class of paper, which I think has a hard time, this was the first appearance consistent with something Joey said about how he finds one way to find research ideas, but I think it's not, is you run a model about topic A, but it turns out that the analysis is very similar to the analysis of some existing topic B. So this one I'll be a little bit more specific on, because this one, in general, I've made many, many mistakes in writing papers and in career and I guess in life as well. But in general, I think I've avoided the first two mistakes I made. Whereas this mistake, every time I write a paper, I fear this is going to happen to me, and sometimes it has. So, for example, many years ago, I wanted to write a paper, and I wrote papers on how the possibility of hiring very persuasive lawyers affects contract design. I thought this would be a nice explanation of why contracts are so incomplete in many dimensions. I still actually think this is a good explanation of why contracts are so incomplete in so many dimensions. But it turned out, I sent this to some journals, and eventually, a referee pointed out, an editor pointed out, that in the end, the same forces, they were exactly the same forces in a very nice paper by Milgram on influencer activities inside a firm. The forces are fundamentally the same as saying managers should have limited discretion because we want to protect them against employees hassling them all the time to change things. And the editor and referee who told me this were completely right. This was a big problem with the paper, which I never really managed to solve. Even though I think this was a good idea, they were right. That someone who understood this older literature well correctly would say that everything in the paper I've written was largely known from this previous literature. So what you should ideally do here, and what in small ways I did manage to do with this particular line of research, although not as much as I would have liked, is that you need to focus on forces which are both new and important in your particular setting, right? So it is possible that just because the broad forces are the same in topic B and topic A, there still might be some particular things you can say, but they have to be sort of genuinely sort of important. They can't just be mere cycles. Okay, so again, sometimes you'll succeed at this. Again, in this case, I feel I had at best partial success. I never really managed to get up with this, that particular piece of challenge. This is not the order I meant it to be. Okay, so let me having said ways to fail, let me describe a couple of examples of success. So here I can be more specific. So I think one paper which I think has been very, very successful, in some sense, really maybe one of the most successful theory papers written in the last 10 years, is this paper which some of you will know by Daly and Green. It's called Waiting for News in the Market for Lemons. I should say that I have no vested interest in this paper at all, right? I don't like these. Neither one is like a close personal friend, and I'm not the referee or anything associated with the paper. But I look at this paper and I think this is a highly successful paper. So why is this a highly successful paper? Fundamentally it's because it tells you something you didn't know when you started reading the paper. So for those of you who don't know the paper, here's a very quick summary. So it's basically, it's Akerlof's Lemons model. It's basically dynamic Akerlof's Lemons model. So remember, in Akerlof, the way it works, the buyer makes an offer. If the seller doesn't sell the seller keeps the car. So the seller's reservation is keeping the car, keeping the asset. But in reality, of course, that's not how the world is. If I decline a particular offer, I have the car, some new buyer arrives tomorrow, I can sell the car to the new buyer. Okay? So the seller's reservation value isn't necessarily just keeping the car, it's the option to sell the car tomorrow. But this is where you sort of head starts to start thinking about this problem. So your reservation value is what I expect to be able to sell the car, or depends in part on what I expect to be able to sell the car at tomorrow. What do I expect to be able to sell the car tomorrow? Well, it depends on the offer I expect to get from the buyer tomorrow. What offer is the buyer going to make me tomorrow? Well, it depends on how the buyer thinks I was behaving with respect to this random offer. If the buyer thinks I was only selling the bad car today, that's going to affect the offer the buyer makes tomorrow. So by this time, you're thinking, I really just don't know what's happening here. Right? So why is this a successful paper? I notice this paper doesn't particularly have a surprise result. Like, you often think a successful paper has to have a surprise. There's no surprise result in this paper. It doesn't explain any particular fact. This isn't a paper that's chasing some particular fact. But why it succeeds is it takes a very fundamental economic force, one we've all completely signed off as being important in the profession, and it takes a setting where it's very hard to sort of predict the equilibrium outcome ahead of time. We clearly want to know the equilibrium outcome, and it's going to tell us what is the equilibrium outcome of the setting. It's a question we want to know the answer to. We didn't know the answer to before we read the paper. After you read the paper, you know the answer. Second example of a paper, which I think has succeeded, is this paper by Donald Levitt on words speak louder without actions. This actually is a paper which has successfully put two forces together. So this is a paper about the mix of cheap talk and intervention. So specifically, think about a manager has information, he's trying to persuade a subordinate to do something. The manager can also intervene in whatever the subordinate ultimately does. Okay? So there's two forces in this paper, there's intervention and communication. This is the kind of place where it's very easy to hear to end up in this mess where you say there's some trade-off, who knows what the outcome of these two forces is. Part of what this paper succeeds at is it puts the two forces together. It has a very clear result, which is the ability to intervene makes the manager communicate less effectively. And it has a very clear intuition for why. It's because the ability to intervene makes the subordinate here take more extreme actions. It's like the subordinate has a bigger conflict of interest with respect to the manager. And so we sort of already know from the cheap talk literature that that makes communication harder. So after the fact, you come away with a very concrete understanding of what's going on here, even though ahead of time you didn't. If I'd asked you what happened here ahead of time, I certainly wouldn't have known. Right? If I'd taken like an hour to think about this problem, I wouldn't have made any progress on this. So there's a paper where after that, I really feel like I learned something. Okay, so before I end, I did want to get to say something about referee reforms, which is the other side of this. So here I'm going to give a mixture of some very specific advice, but also some implications of this idea that what makes it, you know, as a referee, it's also important to remember what makes a good paper. Well, a good paper is one which tells me something I didn't already know before I read the paper about something I care about. So maybe the single most important thing I would like people to remember from this is when you like a paper, it's obviously sadly most of the time it turns out people don't like papers, but when you do like a paper, tell the editor why you like the paper. So you'd be amazed how many referee reports say, I recommend revision, this is a great paper. They don't say why it's a great paper. They immediately go to a bunch of caveats with the paper. And you know, as the editor, you're looking at this and saying, I just don't understand why this paper liked the paper. All they tell me is things they didn't like about the paper. I have no idea why they like the paper in the first place. So make sure you remember why you like the paper. And be as specific here as you can. Don't say it's an interesting paper. Don't say it's a fascinating paper. Don't say it makes a nice contribution to the literature. Really try to be, those things are not especially helpful, as you get it. Try to be as specific as possible about what specific you want. This is the advice I'd recommend, that what are you really trying to judge as a referee? You're trying to judge, did I learn something from the paper I didn't already know about something I care about? More specifically, instead of picking at details, try to start by understanding what the authors are trying to communicate. Try to read, I really advocate this for everything, but particularly, for something as a decision important to referee reports. Try to read the paper in its best possible light. Ask, what is the best paper that this paper could reasonably be? Obviously, there's a lot of sort of judgment in what reasonably here means, but given the model or the empirics the authors have done, what's the best version of this paper that it could become? in general, make sure that you understand things before you critique them. The critique is important. I'm not saying don't get to the critique. I'm just saying make sure you do the understanding first. You would be amazed at how many people sort of skip this step and go straight to this step, right? It's really important to do the understanding step first. And by the way, as an aside, I advocate this rule for seminar participation too, right? In seminars, make sure you understand what the author is saying before you start hassling the author about how they've done the wrong thing. So make sure you understand things before you critique. Here are sort of three very specific requests for referees. If theory papers don't say an assumption is unrealistic, instead you need to explain what implications you're concerned about and why. These are two, if you're more theory oriented, don't say there's an endogeneity concern. Instead, give a credible economic theory or like story is enough, but you need to say credibly what is it you're worried about that's potentially leading to reverse causality or omitted variable bias. Don't just say there's a risk of omitted variable bias. Don't just call for clustering. Say what is the correlation of the data that you're potentially worried about. Don't just say the authors should cluster at the year level. Say why you're worried that the errors might be clustered at the year level. Okay, so I think I must be out of time. In the end, there's one thing I want to communicate here, which is the role of research is to tell the reader something they didn't already know. It sounds very simple. I think we often lose sight of this. I thought, by the way, that John's comments immediately before the break about getting this tension right between we're trying to be open-minded but also judge. I feel this is completely consistent with this. I'm always trying to learn new things, but part of that is whenever I confront something, I'm forced to ask myself, have I indeed learned something new from this paper? So I view this almost my way to balance exactly the tension that John very accurately described. Again, all rules have exceptions. I'm sure mine do too. And after I wrote out these slides, I was concerned that I was concerned that in the end I've fallen short of the standard of advocate. So maybe you'll look at this and maybe you'll think I knew all of this already. Hopefully this will have at least helped you sort of make this more concrete in your mind. That this really, as both an author and as a referee, I think this is the key criteria you should be. Okay, so that's a lot.